Right, Andy, you are now
Okay.
host, so
Okay.
if you
All
would like
right.
to introduce yourself first and then move us into your presentation looking at flipping governance and focusing on academies. Over
Right.
to you.
Okay. Well, hello everyone. Yes, I'm Andy. I completed my doctorate in governance, and specifically empowered and participatory governance. And I've been working with colleagues and Nigel and Abdullah Berdi, sort of developing our research. This current presentation is based on the article I published in Forum, which was just before Christmas. Nigel mentioned Forum, and indeed, probably 3-4 years ago, Nigel and I had an article in Forum too. So that's a little bit about me and the research, and it will obviously unfold as we go through the presentation. So what I need to do now is to share my screen, don't I? So Tracy and I were just discussing how much easier these are and how much more relaxed it is when you're just in a face-to-face environment. So just bear with me and I'll share my screen here. It ought to be that one. And share it. Can people see that?
Yeah, that's good, Andy, here.
Right, okay, yeah, great. I do lecture for the OU here at Middlesbrough College, the University Centre, but we use Teams all the time, so the only time I use Zoom is in these sessions. So on to the paper. What I propose to do, and I've just extracted elements of the paper and put it on a SharePoint, and we can just work through the SharePoint. And I've got a number of questions to put to you just to stimulate a little bit of discussion in some breakout groups at the end of the session. So I called it Flipping Academy Governance, Top Down to Bottom Up. The research, and a number of you have heard the presentations that I've done and colleagues and Nigel, where we sort of challenge the status quo, and our narrative is like a counter narrative to current government policy. Hence sort of flipping the governance system. So the forum, the call for papers was around the white paper and the notion of government policy to actually make every school to become an academy. So the intention of government to create a fully academised school system, further roads community engagement and accountability. So that was the prompt here. So the paper itself, if you haven't been able to read it, illustrates how the policy of academisation has enabled a top-down governance framework to emerge. So I write about the notion of top-down, but what I do in this paper, which is a little bit different to my previous papers, I look at the specific example. At the end of the paper, we present democratic innovations that seek to invert the power base of academized governance. So it sort of creates or argues for a bottom-up participatory governance in a shift to what we might term post-new governance. So the background element in the paper, I started and I shared the paper when it was, almost as a draft, I think, with Ron Glatter. And it was nice to talk it through with you, Ron. It was, inspirational, really. So I started with Ron's paper on persistent preoccupation that he argues that successive governments are preoccupied with autonomy and accountability. And Ron has argued in 2012 in his paper, Persistent Preoccupations, that autonomy is built into the DNA of the education system. And what Ron does is to highlight a Belmas conference, but at the time it was British Education Administration Society, which now is some 47 years ago, that they embraced the theme then of autonomy and accountability. So if we fast forward from then to the current white paper, which is pretty much defunct as we know, but it was still sort of more alive at the time of writing. The white paper is entitled Opportunity for All. Great schools, strong schools with great teachers for a child, but the notion of opportunity for all sort of resonated with me, because if you're focused on governance, then arguably it's not about opportunities for all. And it's my view that the white paper presents a neoliberal dogma that reaffirms a government intention to create trust-led systems that shifted away from local authority and local accountability. Except that in the white paper, of course, it gave local authorities the ability to establish new multi-accountability trusts, but it said where too few strong trusts exist. So it really excludes them, but if there are few strong trusts, then yes, they have a choice. And I did wonder, and I write I put into the paper, it'll be interesting to see how this unfolds and how local authorities respond to the challenge of the white paper, given an illusion of choice. And I say it's an illusion of choice because they risk losing their remaining schools to NATS, or what they need to do is form unnecessary trusts to retain existing families of schools. I have a section in the paper that discusses academy governance, and the paper is the white paper, of course, is Opportunities for All. But in terms of academy governance, the section in the paper is Opportunities for the Few. And I argue that it's opportunities for the few because academies, and we'll see this, it's extensively written, and there's literatures everywhere we look, on the systematic democratic deficit. Ron's written it, Nigel, it's in Nigel's book, if we want to go there. Just lots of evidence, and I'll come on to the evidence later, but a systematic democratic deficit whereby power and control is located usually out of the school, but certainly outside of public accountability systems, and whereby the citizenry have little or no influence over the school. So NATS, to which all schools will belong if government policy driver continues, will be even further distanced from the citizenry than standalone converter academies, where the locus of power, we've got a section in the paper on the locus of power, is centralised over, over geographically dispersed areas. So the power is not within a school, but within the mat. And that mat, of course, could operate across a very wide geographical area. And when that happens, the democratic deficits deepened. And the white paper suggests that trusts should be running at least 10 schools. And at the moment, that's not the case. Obviously, clearly the example that I give is the Academy's Enterprise Trust, and we'll look at them a little bit later. So I argue in the paper that governance voice of individual academies becomes less audible and governance legitimacy becomes more a legacy of more democratic times. So let's look at, before we get onto the example, let's look at some of the evidence non-existent or meaningless community-based governance arrangements within academies. So I just extrapolated a number from the paper. So recently in the House of Commons Committee for Public Accounts, the National Education Union are arguing that there's a deficit of both accountability and transparency in the academy system, and that there's a clear effort by the DfE to distract from the reality of academisation. The House of Commons Education Committee, Education Select Committee sometimes as we refer to it, suggest that they were told by parents that MATs are not sufficiently accountable to the local community and that they feel disconnected from decision-making at trustee board level. And there's too much emphasis on upward accountability and not enough on local engagement. Within that Education Committee report, I thought it was very interesting reading Professors Stapleton and Stafford, who advise that accountability by parents is diminished and that it's unclear how local communities can even get a voice. And I think that is really critical. And I think that will lead the discussion after this presentation, because I think we need to look towards new architectures and new systems of more democratic models. DfE policy is to professionalise and reduce the size of governing boards. We've heard that many times. We heard that from Andrew Wilkins when he presented early last year. More recently, House of Commons Education Committee advised that the DfE, that academies have a duty to be clear. So the DfE has a duty to be clear that local boards, local governing boards, don't really make the decisions. The decisions are held by the Board of Trustees in AMAT and not at local level. However, it does advise that MATs should demonstrate a sincere commitment to outreach and engagement with the local community. But actually, what I don't really know what that means, because to demonstrate a commitment to outreach engagement isn't the same as governance. Does the local governing body really need to take note or act on anything that the local community says? I think it's a difficult one. So, I dropped in the great education robbery, Nigel Gann. It was compelling evidence in the book if you haven't already read it. So you can thank me in the comments, Bar Nigel, for that one. Excellent book. Within my paper, having set a background, I then investigate, and I did investigate this, several years ago, and I put the governance model in my thesis at the time. And I know that Warwick Mansell, in his Education Uncovered, has discussed the previous model with the Academies Enterprise Trust. And actually, the Academies Enterprise Trust from September have begun to reorganize their governance structure. But what I'm focusing on here is the governance structure that they've had for quite a few years now, and was the one in operation right up to, well, during the time of writing and publication. So background on AET, I guess we know AET, but it was once the largest multi-academy trust and arguably one of the government's flagship and sector leading academy chains. At the time of writing, from their website, it operated, or it sponsored, those that know me don't know I don't like the term sponsored, because in my view, the MATs take money from local schools as opposed to sponsoring, which in my term is actually giving the money. But they sponsor 57 schools and hold a revenue budget of 234 million. We see in the diagram there that it's a classic hierarchical structure, and one that in my view excludes stakeholder voice. So to me, it fosters an organisational-wide democratic deficit. So if we look at it, and I can just point, I'm hoping you can see that, we've got the Board of Trustees above that. Now we'll discuss the members, which the members board, which we know about. We'll have a discussion about of the members board. We've got the Board of Trustees, and we can see from this hierarchical structure that we've got committees and well-being, audit risk. We've got head of governance coming down, head of academies governance. We've then got chairs of governing bodies, and it comes down to local governing boards here and parent advisory boards, parent community advisory boards. So let me just go back here. So above the Board of Trustees, we have a members board. Now, the members, according to the EFA. Does anyone know? I was going to suggest in the chat, but I can't see the chat box now I'm presenting. But does would anyone just like to chip in and say, how many members do we think the AAT may have, considering the power and control and the agreement, the funding agreement with the ESFA, the DFE, is actually based with the board of the members board. How many people do we think might be there? Anyone like to chip in?
Three.
Well done, Noreen. Right, first time. You could tweet that. I'm amazed that you've got 20,000 followers on Twitter. But yes, it has three. So let's look. So what I've put into the paper is that the funding agreement with the SFA lies with the members board, that is the power to appoint and remove its trustees. So the power is there. The ESFA currently stipulates that multi-academy trusts must have at least three members. Yeah, although the department's strong preference, so there's a strong preference, is that trust should have at least five members. That's at least five members. And it's further advising that having more than three members provides for a more diverse range of perspectives. And we know that, don't we? It's pretty much common sense. But here at AAT, there are three. So AAT has a minimum membership of three, arguably non-diverse and unrepresentative members. It still has three, even though they've changed their governance structure. So this is contrary to the express preference of the ESFA, a number that could easily be interpreted. Sin is a minimum of three, but you know they really would like at least five. At least five is what, seven, eight, maybe? So three is arguably under half of what the advice, reading between the lines, should be. So my view is that that's incredibly weak. The DfE and the Education Skills Funding Agency and Ofsted, I think, are complicit in allowing AET and other academy chains to establish a governance framework that allows for three unelected and representative members to hold a funding contract for 234 million here, along with the power and responsibility and control of 57 schools, and which is some 32,000 students. I don't know how it's acceptable. The Harris Federation, I drop in just in passing into the paper, currently operates 52 academies and similarly embraces the members board of three, all of whom are part of the Harris family. So that's a dynasty rather than a democracy, in my view. The members too are very closely, and you'll see that the trustees on the board of trustees very closely aligned to government policy. So let's look at some key points here. I argue that the members board aren't really members of any real meaningful organisation, in my view. It's just three unelected people in the case of AET. The members currently, and I find this, and it'd be an interesting discussion point, with the larger mats, you very often, what you see is members and chairs of governors who seem to, and I'm sure they're very nice people and very, very skilled people, but they seem, in my view, to be overloaded. They're on multiple committees. And I can't see how a governor, given the volume of work it is to be a governor, particularly a chair of governor or trustee, can have so many irons in the fire. I mean, if we look at some of the board, the members board, they're on the board of a chair of a university, but they're on the board of the DfE, they're involved with the Specialist Schools Academy Trust, the deputy chairs of health trusts, and for me, I think it almost lacks a focus. So Individuals are drawn, and this the paper discusses this and links to the notion of non-elected elites. The individuals are drawn from a small elite group who are closely aligned to government policy, so it's not really opportunity for all in terms of governance. It's noted by Burns, Hamilton and Hoggart that I put into the paper, and I developed some of their work in my thesis, that a strategy for genuine empowerment would seek to maximize the power of the citizen as opposed to non-elected elites. Further, Skelcher and Toffling advocate the containing of such elites by active and democratically educated citizenship. I did include a ladder of participation here that I discuss a little later on too, because I refer to it as cynical consultation in terms of participation, but we'll come on to that. So what about AET? So that's AET. Oh, let me just make one or two more points. The Board of Trustees, if we go up to here, so we've mentioned the Members Board. The Board of Trustees, again, is a small select group of people. It has on it, I just stepped down, I believe, just before September, but was true at the point of writing and publication. Sir David Carter, former National Schools Commissioner and Deputy Chair of the Education Endowment Foundation. It has on it also the CEO is a former Regional Schools Commissioner. So we've got Schools Commissioner, National Schools Commissioner, people involved in the Education Endowment Foundation. The CEO of the Education Endowment Foundation, which I think in actual fact do an amazing job, and their evidence-based practice is really coming out, but it's still a very small circle. So the CEO of the EEF is on that board too. So the overall governance structure, looking at the Board of Trustees and the Members Board, the overall governance structure is complex, multi-tiered, top-down, and is consistent with Andrew Wilkins' observation of top-down, bureaucratically overloaded models of service delivery and monopolistic practices. So that's at the trust level. What's it at local level? So I thought I'd investigate this by looking at the Academies Enterprise Trust at my local school. I'm here in Middlesbrough. I can almost see the area of town where we have North Ormsby Primary Academy. So at the local level, local governing boards within the AET model are constituted in such a way as to inhibit meaningful stakeholder engagement and voice. Although the trustee, former trustee, Sir David Carter has advised, and this is in Sam Henson's paper, has advised that you can't have a credible vision that talks about supporting and developing school communities if you don't give them a voice. Now, I have no doubt that Sir David Carter doesn't mean that and isn't a supporter, but certainly looking at the trustee level, that's not happening. Whatever the trust think, why isn't it happening at ground level? So let's have a look at the local level. So they've got a local governing board and a parents and community advisory board. So we look at the governing board, and this is we have a narrative on this in the paper. So just cast your eye over this section here. And that's why I relate it to cynical consultation. The local governing board of North Ormsby Primary Academy at the time of writing has the chair, which is a principal of Greenway Academy, who works for Academies Enterprise Trust. It has the regional director, comprised the regional director, Academies Enterprise Trust, the principal of North Ormsby Primary Academy, Academies Enterprise Trust, a board member, Vice Principal of Hall Road School, Academies Enterprise Trust, Board Member of School Support Services, you know where that is too, and a clerk to governors. There is one member from the Parent and Community Advisory Board, and I actually made a call to that person. Didn't appear to me that that were fully engaged and active. I couldn't find any of the governor's papers. You've got to write in and request them. So it is rather opaque. Now, I can't see how here that the board have got any external accountability. They're holding themselves to account. So I suggest in the paper that the governance model exists minimal external scrutiny and can be considered a mode of self-modeling, self-monitoring, a given model of self-monitoring. So according to the governance handbook that I'll link this to, local governing bodies like this, where they exist, are intended to, and this is a governance handbook, provide sufficient diversity of perspectives to enable robust decision-making, provide clear separation between strategic non-executive oversight and operational executive leadership, and is to hold executive leaders to account for the educational performance of the organisation. Well, I don't think that that can work, and I don't see how a trust board at a MAT can see how that can work. Maybe that's why they've changed it, but it's been there for some considerable level length of time. I looked at the Ofsted reports for Northumberland Primary Academy too, and in successive Ofsted inspection reports of the Northumberland Primary Academy, the governance arrangements have not once been subject to comment. So why is it why isn't a considered analysis and critique of governance not a central feature of Ofsted inspections? So that's a little about the composition of the local governing board of one of our local primary schools in Middlesbrough. So moving on to the Parent and Community Advisory Board, we've got, and I did speak to the local church representative. You've got the principal of AET, the parent liaison and school inclusion coordinator of AET. We've got three parents essentially. So we've got three parents, the police officer and the local church representative. And again, the minutes aren't published, but can be requested. I did request the papers, but haven't been sent any, but I did make the request during August. So we can see that stakeholder voice is very difficult to get through here. So in my paper, the next section, having had an analysis of AET, argues a flipped structure. Now, we've written about flipped structures before and discussed flipped structures. So citizen up structures create, and the creation of a meaningful members board is an imperative. So some form of members association or cooperative forum. Again, we've discussed it before, there can be 40 strong. And the notion and the emphasis of the paper is that power and control, rather than being with three unelected elite individuals, should be flipped, and we should really look towards a mechanism that gives the power and control to a members association or a cooperative forum. Mervyn Wilson, I remember discussing with this, he was a former CEO of the Cooperative College. He used to argue that top-down chains of command are not the only way to organise, and that was a fundamental premise in the rolling out of cooperative schools. We need to insist that MATs remain local in the spirit of MAT Governance, The Future is Local, published by Sam, who's in attendance today, of the NGA. And we ought to also ask Tony Benn's five questions that I've put into the paper, questions to the powerful. Again, some of you will know these. They're actually in Nigel's book. I've used them before, but a number of people sort of that I know would move towards or look towards those questions. So Tony Benn's five questions to the powerful in relation to academised governance might read, what power have you got? This could be to the members. What power have you got? Where did you get it from? I don't know where they got it from. In whose interest you exercised it? to whom are you accountable, and how do we get rid of you? What I would say, and I'll just scroll up here again, if we've got a local governing board that's basically members, well, essentially members of AAT, and the parent community board is very weak, how can the local governing board, which are employees of AET, exert upward pressure against their line managers? I think that would be problematic. Yeah, really problematic. I was going to make a point there, Abdullah, in relation to our staff governors, but clearly they're not staff governors in the same way that we would view them. They're not elected staff governors. So moving back down, we've discussed Tony Benn's five questions, and I'm on the last section now. So citizen up structures are needed. So this moves towards post new governance. So we know about new governance and new public management and the notion that we run our schools like a business in a market. Place. So if that's new governance, we need to move away from that. We need to be post-new governance. So Skelcher and Toffling observe that the performance of multi-layered and tangled governance systems is hampered by a persistent lack of democratic legitimacy. And I think that's what we see here. We see it in academy chains. So a system-wide shift to post-new governance is an imperative. Post-new governance is a phase that is informed by imaginative democratic innovation. So in my paper, I just list one or two examples, but essentially it's there to get a discussion, to try and help the discussion along. The NGA have had the discussion going actually for some time, but this is a small contribution too. So we need, it's arguing for forms of empowered and participatory governance where institutional design is argued to enhance civic participation and increase citizens' sense of democratic ownership. So to conclude, we argue, or I argue in the paper, that the prevailing ideological, and I'll just read this, it's a conclusion, the prevailing ideological discourse is academisation, and drawing on Fielding and Moss, it's a dictatorship of no alternative. Yet I argue that democratic alternatives exist, and the compelling counter-narratives to academised systems and structures must be explored and promoted. So a flipped governance models that are proposed are feasible and are presented here for analysis and critique within a developing narrative that we contribute of democratic innovation to sustain a concept of comprehensive community education. And I'll finish there, Lizana. And thank you for listening.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Andy. I'm just going to stop the recording. It wouldn't allow me. So I'm just going to take back the hosting powers just quickly and then do that for us. Lovely. And